Everyone, and good evening, Dr. Bob. How are
you? Hello, John. Hello, everyone.
You have some big sessions and mixing stuff this week, I suppose?
Yes, yes.
That's great.
Finishing up some projects for the year, a few mixes for the year. Got some movie stuff coming up. Got some record stuff coming up for next year. So happy to get things done, take a small break, and get back at it. How is the movie business, the film business, the editing business, the mixing business?
It's a little busy. I just got back from Port Arthur and Venton and Lake Charles and had to run down there and get a bunch of stuff done and film. Actually, I didn't realize Bobby's cousin is the assistant to the mayor. So they called all the sheriffs and police and cleared the town so I could film the drone right down the street.
That's awesome.
And said, don't mess with him. So that was all good. Great. But I had a great day today. Had a special session with our guest tonight, Mickey Thomas. He honored Bobby.
This is amazing, man. Like last week we had Bill Champlin, and this week we have Mickey Thomas. Like, this is me living my heroes right in front. I mean, I hope I'm like listening a blubbering fool on these things, because I've wanted to ask questions to these guys for years.
Right. And they're icons. They are the icons of this industry. And Mickey still, as I'm sure he'll attest to here in a little bit, he's still singing this stuff in the original keys. His pipes are still, I mean, it's a special thing.
Very, 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 very few can even still sing it a step down. That's amazing. Amazing. Well, I can't wait to talk to him and ask him questions and like see Mickey Thomas on here. That's amazing.
Right. Well, you know, it's a special fairy dust from Cairo, Georgia, that they serve up down there to those youngins. And it keeps them singing forever. So without further ado, originally from Cairo, Texas. Now he's out in the desert, and I won't give locations out, but and he's become a good friend. I mean, I go back to 1996. I tell the story in the film. In fact, I was telling him today, McDonald canceled. I don't know why. And a lot of people are like, how can you put two tenors together? It worked. And it was a special moment.
You mean Michael McDonald, right?
Michael McDonald, excuse me. Michael McDonald. I was driving my car across the bridge, 3:40 in the morning, coming from Hyde Street. The Michael McDonald stuff was canceled, and a track came on their rock radio station in the Bay called Sorry Me, Sorry You. And you'll see in the video, in the movie, I almost swerved the car into the side of the Bay Bridge. I'm panicking because I just realized, click, 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 this works, this works. And I pull off at Christie Avenue. There's a Denny's. I'm running across the parking lot to get to the phone in the little lobby there to call Bobby at the Phoenix. Do you have Mickey's number? Of course I do.
Well, of course.
And the next day I call him, and it's, you know, literally the day after that or whatever. That was January 17th, 1996. And he came down there, and I met him, and we became friends. And he did such a wonderful job on there, and him and Bobby were so close and performed forever together, PGA events, everything. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, the incomparable Mickey Thomas, let's bring him in.
There he is.
Hey. Yeah.
It's Christmas time.
Well, I may have to dim the lights. I'm brighter than you guys, you know. I'll get some mood lighting going.
Hey, nothing to hide, man.
Let's put him in the middle. There he goes.
There we go.
Oh, all right.
Well, actually, I'm going to put you on the side because when I put your banners up, it's going to cut your face off.
Okay.
So I want to tell everybody right now that Mickey has, for Mickey Thomas merchandise and his latest releases, there'll be banners coming up on the screen, and you just take your phone like this, you put it on the camera, and you put it up to those little codes next to the verbiage, and it'll take you directly. You tap on it, takes you directly to Starship Control, Starship's website, and their merch is in there. You can shop, you can find out where they're playing. His release is in there as well. But then I have another QR code that takes you right to Spotify to his latest releases. And to make it clear to everybody, do we want to start the show on that note, or should we just get into the other stuff first? The real, there's been a lot of confusion, and I've watched it go online, and I've reached out to Mickey, and he's very busy, and I'm sure it drives him crazy, but some of my friends in Detroit actually were commenting on this post, wow, Mickey's not singing that great, and I looked at the post, I knew right away this wasn't Mickey, and yeah. It was a girl, and there was a guy, an older guy, and I listened to him, and they're like, yeah, from this album, Starship, you know, they're acting like it's their album, and then they would say, this is We Built This City, and so people were misinformed. That group of people is this Facebook page here, and I don't even, Mickey can clarify it, but I don't even know if it's any original member is in there, is there?
David Freiberg probably is the only original member.
Bass player?
Bass player and singer. He's now the singer who sometimes, as you mentioned, people confuse with me when he's singing, you know, a lot of the songs I did with Jefferson Starship and then later Starship.
Right. And then this is Mickey's Starship. This is the band that performs all of those monsters.
The good looking guys.
The good looking guys. Look, you guys are all rocked up there.
That's right.
So Starship featuring Mickey Thomas. So I mean, it pains me because I'm friends with you and I've worked in the studio with you and I've known you and you're such a soft-spoken, nice guy. And it's like to see this go down like that kind of bothered me. And how have you dealt with this? I mean, it's got to be complicated.
Yeah, I try to ignore it as much as possible. But what happened was, you know, when we officially shortened our name to Starship, we retired the name Jefferson Starship legally forever. So after 1985, no one was ever supposed to use the name Jefferson Starship again. But then in the early to mid 90s, Paul Kantner didn't really have much else going for him and wanted to get back out on the road and do some shows and perform. So he talked Grace Slick and our former manager Bill Thompson into letting him unretire the name Jefferson Starship. So Paul started performing as Jefferson Starship, and that was, you know, I could kind of say, okay, you know, we can coexist here, you know, because at that point, what he was doing was so different from what I was doing. I was doing all the Starship stuff, my early Jefferson Starship stuff, like Jane and Find Your Way Back and No Way Out. And so there was, and he was doing the earlier Jefferson Starship, like Ride the Tiger and Wooden Ships and
Miracles
and a lot of the Jefferson Airplane stuff. So they were two sort of distinctly different bands going on then. And then plus, Paul had bad rap Starship so much that it wouldn't be, let's say, morally, he couldn't morally do any of the Starship songs and not look like a total hypocrite, you know, so he didn't. And then when Paul passed away, I thought, well, that's probably going to be the end of Jefferson Starship. I didn't really see them continuing on without Paul. Marty had been involved for a while too, Marty Ballin with Paul, and Marty also passed away. And so I figured that was the end of it, but they decided to continue on anyway. And not only did they continue on, but they started incorporating Starship songs into their show and doing some of the Jefferson Starship songs that I had recorded. So that really does muddy the waters sometimes. Yeah. And it's confusing to people, confusing in the marketplace, because I get friends calling me all the time too, saying, hey man, you're gonna be in Memphis tonight. I go, well, no, I'm not actually, I'm in Phoenix, but there's this other band and it's not me. And you know, if they would kind of stick to the concept that they had going when Paul Kantner first reformed the band, it might make more sense for us to mutually coexist. But the fact that they're not only performing Starship songs in their show, but also use Starship songs with my voice to advertise their show is...
I saw that.
That bothers me, yeah.
I saw that as well. And I heard one of their advertisements when I was in Vegas. And they were was it them and Loverboy or somebody were doing a show together, and it was, the cue was Jane, and like we built this, and it was the original recording, and Sarah.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
We've had some discussions.
That's what
I, because, you know, I mean, you always want to avoid going down the legal avenue, you know, if you can, because that usually, you know, the old adage, only people who win then are usually the attorneys. But so we've had some conversations, my management with their management, about at least take the songs out of your advertisements for your shows, you know, because that really is false advertising. So we're working with them, you know, we're trying to trying to get it all straightened out.
Well, yeah, and it might be a little cool too if they said, like, when they're doing these shows, they say, now here's a song, Sarah, from this album, and they said, you know, nobody can do it as good as Mickey or anything, you know, to refer to, because the song was written by Peter and his wife for
Peter Wolf, yeah,
yeah, for your relationship with your ex-wife. No,
well, sort of loosely. Peter wanted to write a song that had my wife at that time, Sarah, just wanted to have her name in the title, because at that point in time, I couldn't really say that it was about us, because Sarah's really a breakup song, right? You know, parting ways, and no time is a good time for goodbye, and that sort of thing. So I didn't think it really applied to me in 1985, but since then, life has imitated art. And
what? I mean, what did Peter Wolf?
Sarah's long gone. And,
what did Peter Wolf know that you didn't know?
Yeah, and you know, he somehow, I guess, he had a.
You know, that's kind of. I want to kind of segue into that, Mickey, for a second. I mean, you've worked with about every one of the greatest producers imaginable, from Keith Olsen, Keith Olsen to Ron Nevison, to, and I mean, I could go on and on, but there's three that I'd like to ask you questions about, just because everyone wonders what it's like in the studio and your relationship with these guys and what they make you do and whatever. So the first one I want to ask about, I've always been a huge Peter Wolf fan, you know, you guys, Wang Chung, El DeBarge. I mean, you know, so, and I know he was a big Synclavier guy, big programmer.
Mm-hmm.
And did you first meet him on the Ron Nevison Nuclear Furniture record, Peter, as a player?
Yes.
Okay.
He did. He had written a song called No Way Out.
Incredible song.
Great song.
Yeah.
Which Ron Nevison brought in for us during the Nuclear Furniture sessions, and had Peter come in and play on it as well. So we got to meet him, and I got to know Peter, and it was just... I love working with Peter so much. It's just one of the greatest experiences ever, because he's so energetic, you know, so talented. He has 10,000 ideas, you know, going on, you know, at once in his head. So, which is great. But the other side was that sometimes you got to filter through all that and say, well, let's try to hone in on what actually works and what, what might. But great energy. And I had so much fun working with him on the, you know, once we got to know Peter during the Nuclear Furniture sessions, then when Nevison wasn't available for the Knee Deep in the Hoopla album, and that was that kind of opened the door for us to have Peter Wolf come in and produce that album. And, you know, it was we were actually, you know, consciously looking to reinvent the band at that point in time. So having somebody like Peter involved just really aided that process. And the fact that, as you mentioned, he brought in the Synclavier and all of the cutting edge new recording techniques that were starting to happen that time, all of the electronics that were going on in the recording process, and the whole transition from analog to digital. Peter was he was the champion of that. So it was a very
pretty much pretty much the best at it.
Yeah, well, he was right at the forefront.
Yeah.
You know, he had the first Synclavier that I ever saw.
Yeah.
Probably the first one or two that was ever in this country, I'm assuming. And because then, I mean, you know, it wasn't an easy instrument to get. The inner workings of the Synclavier was like a nuclear submarine. or something. You know, it was so intricate and so amazing. And
it cost as much as an expensive house.
I think it cost, this is 1985, I think it cost $500,000.
Yeah, that's a lot of money. Yeah. So obviously you've worked with a lot of producers as they help you or they work with you through vocals. What was your process like singing with Peter? Like, would he want you to do a bunch of takes or just a few? Or do you remember how that went?
Yeah, he was, Peter was a guy, not a lot of takes guy. You know, he would sort of let me express myself the way I wanted to, because I'm kind of best. I mean, I like to do multiple tracks, multiple takes, but I like to have the freedom to kind of, you know, change it up every time I do it, you know, sing it a little differently every time. And he was way into that and gave me a lot of artistic freedom as far as that process goes. He was, you know, I mean, he was really good if I needed help with a melody or something, you know, because obviously he has such a fantastic ear and is such a incredible music talent that he could help me with the nuances of melody and things like that.
Sure.
But he pretty much just put the mic in front of me and let me go.
All right. Well, then let's jump to the opposite. You know what's coming.
Hey, hang on one second. Mickey, this guy right here, Carlos Baez, is the guy from Puerto Rico that's been trying for a year to get you on a session. Yeah. I will give you the information when we're done and send it to you. We'll take care of that later. Now, go ahead, Bobby.
Do I need to say the name, or do you just want to start telling me about it, Mickey?
Are you going to say Mutt Lang?
Yeah.
Def Leppard? Didn't you tell me one time you did Def Leppard? You and Grace did backgrounds, or you were in London or somewhere? Or
no, I did not. Well, Def Leppard, but I did one of the lead vocals for the Love Among the Cannibals album, a song called I Didn't Mean to Stay All Night, which Mutt Lang wrote. So Mutt was kind of letting his protege at that point in time, Mike Shipley, produce the album. Mike Shipley and Larry Klein were producing it. But when it came to Mutt's song, of course, he wanted to get more hands on with that one, because, you know, it was a song that was very close to him, close to his heart personally, too. So I had always wanted to record in England, and I had never recorded anything in England before.
Really?
You know, being a child of the 60s. And, you know, the reason I started doing this was like the Beatles and the Stones and, you know, the original British invasion of all those bands. So I never got to record in England. So Mutt said, "We'll come to England and we'll do the lead vocal." And I Didn't Mean to Stay All Night. So I said, "Oh, great, that'll be fun." So I went over there, just me, none of the rest of the band, no managers, you know, no friends, nobody, just me. And so it was just Mutt and me and Shipley in the studio doing the vocal for I Didn't Mean to Stay All Night. And it was, I like to refer to Mutt as the Stanley Kubrick of music, because, you know, Kubrick is so famous for how many takes he makes the actors go through for any particular scene. So Mutt was kind of like that. We didn't work with, there was no comping. There was no like, all right, here you go, sing it four times and we'll pick out all the best parts or whatever and comp it together. It was bit by bit by grueling bit.
Really? You know, like,
sing a line. He would do it line by line by line. But you'd sing the line over and over and over, like 25, 30 times maybe. And then all of a sudden he'd say, "Moving on." You know, and I go, and I'm thinking like, well, what did I do differently that I didn't do the last 20 times on that take, you know? So it was his methods where it made me want to pull my hair out. But I thought, being the person that I am and having the temperament that I have, I thought, well, rather than lose it, I'm just going to, you know, I'm not going to let him like break me or make me lose my shit here. I'm just going to say, I'm going to go.
Yeah,
with his method, we're gonna do it his way, and it's gonna be great. And
he's very friendly about it too.
He's a great guy. That's the thing about it. It's just not like he's ever a jerk or anything, you know.
Yeah,
he's a real wonderful, really nice, personable human being. But his process will just like you want to pull your hair out sometimes. Yeah. At least me. I mean, you know, and I've heard some things. I think Joe Elliott may have had some of the same feelings.
Yeah.
In making the Def Leppard album.
Yeah, I thought that you did some backgrounds on there one time. You were telling me.
No, we did. What Grace and I did, we did some background vocals on the Heart album, and that Ron Nevison was doing back in 1985. That had several big hits for them off of that album. What About Love and These Dreams, and sang on a few of those songs with Grace.
Yeah.
Well, I'm surprised I never picked your voice out. You're pretty dead ringer. Although somebody was sending a question. Michael had it somewhere. He doesn't have it up here. And I think you answered it about Syeda Garrett earlier today.
Oh, yeah.
What was up with that session?
Oh, man. Well, Peter Wolf brought in Syeda. Wow. A whole group of background singers.
Here it is right here. Yeah. I've always loved the song Wings of... Of a Lie.
Wings of a Lie, yeah.
Written by Peter and his wife, off the starship, no protection.
Yeah.
Was there ever a discussion by the band or the label about releasing it as a single?
Yeah, I think, I know there was discussion about releasing it as a single. I don't know if we did. We had the one, well, you know, obviously it was the No Protection album, so Nothing's Gonna Stop Us Now was the first single that was actually done before we started working on that album, but it was included on the album. And then It's Not Over Till It's Over was the second single from that album. It was a top 10 single. And then we actually put out Set the Night to Music, which didn't happen for us for some reason. It just didn't catch on. But then a couple of years after that, Roberta Flack and Maxi Priest had a pretty big hit with it.
Yeah.
The cover version of it. And I remember being at some, like BMG, RCA, our label was bought out by BMG, so they were BMG by then. And I was at some big record party somewhere in New York, and they were just playing all kind of music, and they played, and Set the Night to Music came on, and one of the record company executives from BMG said, "You guys should have put this out as a single." I said, "We did." You guys dropped the ball, remember?
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Now,
does that pretty much sum up a record deal right there?
Yeah. that was the deal with BMG.
So also the Danger Zone thing, because I know people were talking when you went in the studio and tracked it. Now, there's a couple stories, because there's one out there that Lukather put out not too long ago, or I think it's been out for a while, that they asked Toto and you guys both turned it down.
Yeah, I wasn't aware of Toto, but I believe we were first choice, and we turned it down. I really liked it. I really wanted to do it. Grace thought that the movie was a little too pro-war at that point in time, so that maybe we shouldn't do the song because of that, to be associated with the movie that was kind of pushing war or whatever, which I think was kind of a ridiculous take, especially at that point in time. But I didn't really want to like butt heads too much then. If I'd known then what I know now,
butt heads.
I would have said, "Screw you, we're doing the damn song," all right?
Right. That thing would have still been a cash cow with the latest release. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's one of my biggest disappointments, that we didn't do that song, because it would fit perfectly in the Starship set too.
Right? Sure. Right, as well.
Yeah. And your range on that.
Yeah. And then subsequently, a few years back, I had a gig with Kenny in Hawaii, and we were talking about it. And he said he thought that Toto was the ones who had passed on it first. And they may have passed on it as well. I don't know. But he said, "I always thought it was Toto." I said, "No, it was Starship, man."
There's something out there on the Toto sites I ran across not too long ago where Steve Lukather talks about they turned it down.
Mm-hmm.
So it probably was you guys first, them.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it landed in Kenny's lap, I guess. But then you had Wild Again. I thought that was a great song in Cocktail. Yeah. The movie was kind of.
Yeah, you know, it's not one of Cruise's greatest films, but you know, it's okay. It's entertaining. You know, it's kind of fun.
Elizabeth Shue
comes on Showtime every now and then or whatever, you know, late at night. It's kind of a fun watch. But Wild Again was the first single from that soundtrack. And it was just kind of didn't do a whole lot, kind of mid-chart. You know, I sort of thought that was going to be a bigger one too.
Yeah,
but the album did great after that. Like after that, like there were three or four top 10 singles that came off of that soundtrack.
Right. Robbie Neville was on there.
Yeah.
Back on Holiday.
Kokomo.
Yeah.
Bobby McFerrin. Don't worry.
Be happy.
Oh, wow. So
it was a huge soundtrack. I think the soundtrack did like 6-7 million or something.
What's this? Starship's version of Set the Night to Music was the end credit song of the film Judge Reinhold, Fred Savage, 80s film, Vice Versa.
Yeah.
This guy, Michael Haddon, my friend that's typing these, he's like a musicologist. He can tell you what melody you actually sang in 76 on something. He knows it all, man.
Because I don't know.
Yeah. So Cairo.
Cairo.
Saying it wrong. Yeah. Cairo. Yeah. Sorry.
That's okay.
I've been saying that since I drove
through
there.
It's spelled like Cairo, obviously, like Cairo, Egypt. But yeah, pronounced Cairo like the syrup, like K-A-R-O.
Do you have any family back there still? Or?
Well, yeah. My brother, his wife, his two of his three kids all still live in Cairo, the town that I was born and grew up in. And, you know, both my parents were there until they passed away. And my sister was not too far away. She had moved down to Destin, Florida. It's about maybe a 3-hour drive from Cairo. And she's since passed away too. But my brother's still there, still going strong.
I'm sorry about your sister.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. She went way too early, way too young. But
yeah. So, you know, what's interesting is when I was interviewing David, well, you've been interviewed, all these, thank you again for being in the movie, being a part of it, all these people. But when David Page was talking about the areas around there, where you and Bobby come from,
yeah,
he kind of paused and he was sitting there next to his piano and he said, you know, it kind of reminds me of like the spiritual kind of gospel church thing. And it's just they have that special vocal about them, you know. They don't play sing. And when Steve Lukather talks in the film, he talks about Bobby, and you're actually the same way. You guys play stuff on the backside of the beat, which is, you know, Vinnie Caliuta said the best players in the world play on the backside of the beat, so this, why not the singers sing there too?
Yeah,
I mean,
I think that was probably the biggest factor in my friendship with Bobby originally when we met each other back in the 70s, is that we had similar experiences in that we were both from the Deep South. And we both ended up in famous West Coast rock and roll bands with Jefferson Starship and Toto, and then me with Elvin Bishop Band before that. And so that was kind of a little bond that we felt, you know, that we shared. There coming, you know, two Southern boys on the West Coast, and also our musical backgrounds similar. You know, my biggest influences were R&B singers, and then I met my mentor, who was a gospel singer named Gideon, who really taught me how to sing. And Bobby already had that. I mean, he grew up right in the middle of that New Orleans, Louisiana music, you know, with the second line and all that stuff, you know, and the blues and the gospel and that whole blend of great music that exists in Southern Louisiana. And so we definitely had a camaraderie around all that stuff.
Right. Now, when you were with Elvin, well, it starts with the Jets, then to Elvin Bishop, correct? Is that how?
Yes.
Okay, but when you were with Elvin Bishop, did you and Bobby, I don't think I ever asked you, when he was with SS Fools, did you guys cross paths then, or was it after he got into Toto and you got to Stars Jefferson?
I think it was right after that, probably after he got into Toto. It was probably around 78, I'm thinking, right in there that we met, when I was kind of in my transition period from Elvin Bishop to joining the Jefferson Starship. I remember one of the first Well, the first single that came out that I did with Jefferson Starship was Jane, right? So, and Toto had just had a huge hit with Hold the Line. So the piano intros are kind of similar there on that, you know? So Jane comes out, it's a big hit, and Bobby calls me up and says, "Hey man, somebody just asked me, hey, you guys got a new single out called Jane?"
Said, sure.
No, that's Jefferson Starship, man. So
that's funny.
And then we played not long after that down at Universal in LA. And Bobby came down to the gig and hung out, and we got to know each other even more.
That's great. And just looking through some credits too, it looked like you've done stuff with Jeff Porcaro, David Page, Steve Porcaro, yeah. Steve Lukather, on your older solo records and other yeah. records besides that.
Yeah. A lot of I've had a yeah you know been lucky enough to play well you know the, my first solo album it was kind of an interesting band that we had for that in that we had Steve Cropper, Duck Dunn, and Booker T on guitar, bass, organ, and then on piano and drums we had David Page and Jeff Porcaro.
Wow.
So it was kind of like the yeah. old school session cats with the new hot young yeah. Prodigies yeah. Were, David and Jeff that were yeah. just exploding onto the scene then in Los Angeles.
Yeah. Was that a good experience?
Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah. I went, whoa, what a band,
I mean, yeah.
Geez. Yeah. It's like I said, the best of the iconic session players from the 60s
yeah.
with the hot young cats,
Yeah. Was, so you were making that record going, man, I know what I got here. This is awesome.
Yeah.
That's killer. What a great feeling to have during making a record.
Oh, yeah, it was a lot of fun. So much fun. And plus, yeah. Cropper was very involved in it. So he was like a father figure to me and just loved working with him. And and then later, subsequently, the next solo album, Steve Porcaro came and played on that one. I've done several projects with Lukather over the years. He's obviously he's one of the best, the handful of the best guitarists in the world,
Sure, absolutely. Yeah.
You see this comment right here?
Me?
Yeah. Can you see
I'd have this to put on my reading glasses.
I always thought Aldo Nova, was there a copyright situation with that?
There was a little bit of one. We looked into that one. It wasn't quite enough for a lawsuit against him for plagiarizing Jane, but it was really, really close.
Really?
Yeah.
Here's a Tennington Park. Just wondering if there's ever going to be any more Tennington Park supergroup stuff. That's kind of, Bill and Mickey, I kind of laid it in their lap after we did the work to do thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that Bill was thinking us, what was he thinking, Sam? And
well, no, we talked about doing some Righteous Brothers stuff.
Right.
With Bill and me, which would be a lot of fun because, very similar kind of voices to, Medley and Bobby there, but with Bill and me. So that'd be a lot of fun. I wouldn't mind trying that. We talked about it, but you know how it is. It's so hard to. It's easy to talk about stuff, but it's really hard to just get.
Well, yeah, especially with your schedule before the pandemic, were you still up to about 200 dates a year or were
you? Oh, probably about 100 before the pandemic. And I'm probably doing about 50 or 60 now.
Right. Are you purposely or is it just the way of the world since the pandemic?
Just kind of the way it's evolved, but 50 or 60 is good for me. I don't really need to do that much more.
A lot of corporates.
Yeah, some. I'd like to do more corporates. Corporates are fun because they're usually in really nice places.
Yeah, with nice money.
Yeah, good money, nice venues, good hotels.
Nice hotel.
All
that kind of stuff,
yeah.
Good food.
Yeah.
Right.
That's super cool.
I was going to ask you. Damn it.
I was going to ask. One more question on the producer thing. Yeah. Was your biggest hit, the biggest Starship hit with Narada Michael Walden?
Probably.
Is it nothing gonna stop us? Was that the biggest hit? And that was Narada?
Yes. That was him. That was the one and only song he ever produced with us. I think if you add it all up, radio and chart positions and all that, it's a close call between Nothing's Gonna Stop Us and We Built This City as to the biggest Starship single, but it's probably Nothing. And that was another great magical combination that happened there, because I got the demo from the song for the song, and you know, it was obviously going to be in the movie Mannequin, and we were offered to do it, and I thought, well, it would be kind of a nice change of pace musically for Starship, because it had a nice little R&B kind of groove to it. It's Diane Warren wrote it.
And real quick, that was her first ever American number one hit.
And I never let her forget it either. She's had many, many more since then. But that was
Where's the money, Diane?
That was her first one, you know. And so listened to the demo, thought, yes, this could work. It'd be a really good vehicle for Grace and me to do something sort of different musically. But at the time, and I just kind of threw this out there, not thinking it would happen, but I said, but Nardo Michael Wallen has got to produce it for it.
Really?
Yeah. And he was really hot then with Whitney Houston and Aretha and all that. And he was in the San Francisco Bay Area. He has a studio there. So they threw it out to him. And right away he said, yeah, I'll do it. Wow. Man, I want to do it.
Yeah.
So then we said, okay. Tarpon.
Tarpon's a super nice guy.
Is it Tarpon?
Yeah. He's like about the nicest guy you'd ever meet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That man's full of love, let me tell you.
He is, yeah.
Yeah. But the funny thing is, now this is 1987, right? So there's no cell phones, and we're in the middle of a tour, and we have a break of about 4 or 5 days where we're going to be home, where we want to like get this track cut and get the vocals done, get it mixed, get it ready to go in a short period of time. So Michael Narda wanted to know, like, well, we got to have the right key for it. So we said, okay, we're in the middle of the tour, but next Wednesday at 3 o'clock our time and 1 o'clock your time or whatever, the tour bus is going to pull over to a phone booth on the side of the road, and we'll figure out the key over the phone.
That's awesome.
And that's how we did it.
No way.
I was in a phone booth singing the
Man, what a story. That's how you found the key to the song?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
How was it working with him? What's he like as far as tracking vocals with him? Is he one take, or is it, you know, line by line, or how'd it go?
No. He was great. You know, he was like, no, just go, just sing, you know, just do it. And, you know, we fixed whatever needed to be fixed. But no, he's one of those guys, just sing the whole song, top to bottom, you know, just get the feel, get the spirit, you know, capture the magic, and then we'll fix whatever little tiny things we need to.
Oh, so you just ran the whole thing down.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Grace and me. Well, I did my part and then she did her part. So ironically, she was doing the lower part when we first started recording the song, the first part of the verse. And then I would come in with the higher part, because that's kind of normally, you know, structurally the way we would usually do it for Starship songs. But Narda, in his brilliance, said, what if you sing the first part in your kind of low, smoky voice, and then we'll have Grace come in with the higher part?
Wow, yeah.
And said, yeah. And then, you know, of course, that was one of the many things that probably made the song such a
gigantic. Yeah, because you're singing pretty low in that verse.
Very low
for me. Not characteristic of of you singing a verse.
But he said, you know, just make it smoky.
Wow.
You know, smoky and husky.
Amazing.
But okay, I can be smoky.
A year or a year and a half, you guys had 3 number one hits?
We had 3 number ones in 18 months, yeah.
Man. Crazy, 18 huh? months.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
It was pretty nuts.
Were you just like, the other shoe's got to drop or something, or were you just rolling with it?
Yeah, something really bad's got to happen to even all this out.
I got to get a stale Twinkie or something.
When you're kind of in the midst of it, though, in the middle of all of that happening, you don't really have time to really think about it a whole lot or trip on it. You know, it's just later on you look back and go, wow, We had three number ones in 18 months, and Springsteen's never had a number one single. How nuts is that?
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, he had one number one, but he didn't sing it. He wrote it, Blinded by the Light.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You're right.
Born in the USA never went number one?
Mm-mm.
Wow. As much as that was drilled all over the radio.
I know. Yeah.
But I remember when that song was hitting, I think, because I was living in this city on another side of the town, and
what city are you in, by the way?
Where am I at now?
Yeah.
In my studio.
And that's in what city?
Dallas, Texas.
Dallas, Texas. Yep.
It's at 12345 Palm Street.
Seriously?
No.
12345.
No, it's at 5221 Tennington Park.
Tennington Park, of course. Yeah.
Right. Work to do. We got work to do.
Yeah.
But Laying It on the Line, I think, just came out when Springsteen, you guys were that summer and he was a little earlier or something. Because I remember all that stuff was happening at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah. I think Born in the USA, I think it was 1984.
Oh, it was?
I'm not for sure. It was somewhere.
Yeah. Right. Okay, so, Mickey, out of all of these Jefferson Starship and Starship Records, and is there one that you just, I mean, because you sing this stuff, or you have been night after night for all these years, it's like, is there a song that nobody would guess that is like one of your favorites? You know, like for me, what got me to you was Sorry Me, Sorry You. And most people are like, what's that? And I said, you don't understand the ad-libs, man. Because you start ad-libs in the first chorus and then you keep going from there and you go up.
I know. Oh, God. This guy needs to learn some pacing, right?
No, but it was like gentle, the first one, even though you're wet, you're in that rarefied air, and then you get going later. You know, I never did ask you that song. I don't even know who wrote the song.
Pete Sears. Pete and Jeanette Sears wrote that one.
Did you like the tune?
Probably wasn't one of my favorites. Which album was that? Was that on Modern Times, or was it Nuclear Furniture?
Nuclear Furniture.
Okay. My favorites there were No Way Out, Laying It on the Line. I think there was, I'm trying to remember, I haven't looked at it.
I mean, I just wondered if you even liked the tune, but I mean, obviously, you know, whose idea was it, you to just go, I got to do these ad-libs on the first chorus, and I got to do.
Yeah, I'm sure those were probably my idea.
Yeah.
They just said, okay, have at it. Knock yourself out.
Mickey, what do you do?
You better save up something for the second chorus, right?
Right. Well, and you did. You took it even further up.
And you've been hitting these high notes quite a few times. What do you do to take care of your throat, your instrument? Are you like particular about it, or are you just one of those lucky guys that bad stuff doesn't happen?
I'm mostly one of those lucky guys that just has been given a gift that has been very good to me. Obviously I try to, I don't abuse myself. You know, I don't, I'm reasonably healthy. You know, my biggest vice is my Chardonnay. I like to drink wine, but I eat right. Mm-hmm. And I try to stay in pretty good shape and,
yes.
Try to get enough rest. That's not always easy to do on the road, but lack of sleep is one of the toughest things on my voice. Mm-hmm. So I do that. Steam showers on the road.
You and Bobby.
Yeah, good steam.
Do you remember knocking on Bobby's door and opening it? And it's like, where's Bobby? And it's And you hear from the middle, Ma over here.
And if all else fails, John, right? Just Lay's potato chips, right?
Lay's,
yeah.
Yeah, the hillbilly lozenges.
Hillbilly lozenge, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm serious. Next time you're having any, just carry a bag with you. Bill swears by it. Everybody, and Bobby showed Bill.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, it works. And Jeannie Tracy was talking about it too in my interview with them in Oakland. Right.
Whatever it takes, man.
Yeah. Right.
Well, I mean, it's better than those ginger chews ripping your molars out, right?
Yeah, that's true too. Yeah.
Did he ever make you eat those ginger chews?
No, I never tried one of those.
High Street was still sending rappers back to me 10 years later. And the water.
Well, yeah, lots of water is good, though. You got to hydrate. Yep.
Right.
For sure.
Right. Right. So, but I was going to, what I was asking you, and I went back into sorry me, sorry you, and I'm sorry about that, everyone. And sorry you, sorry me. Out of all these stars, Jefferson Starship and Starship, is there one that people wouldn't guess that is probably your favorite track to that you don't get to do a lot or you never?
Yeah, probably a lot of them from the Love Among the Cannibals album, because I think that was I think that's the best album that we ever did, that I was ever part of. And you know, it wasn't the most successful album, but it's my favorite. I think it's the best album we did. It's the album that all these years later, it really holds up very well sonically. That's the one that had the Mutt Lange song on it, by the way. I didn't mean to stay all night. And it's got, oh, we also worked on about five or six tracks on that album. Tom Lord Alge.
Yeah.
Who was also a blast to work with.
Yeah.
That was great. So there's several songs on the Cannibals that people probably would never have heard unless they have the album. But Healing Waters is one that I really like a lot. One called Send Me a Message. Yeah. Cool. Probably Healing Waters more than any, though.
Yeah, somebody's commenting, Michael Haddad's commenting again about, I love Mickey's vocal on a song called Sing, written by Jonathan Cain and Martin Page and Dean Pitchford.
Yeah.
It's from an 88 film.
Yeah.
Flew Under the Radar, it says. You did a lot of work with Martin Page, didn't you?
Yeah. Martin is a co-writer on We Built the City. You know, he's a co-writer on It's Not Enough, which was a pretty big hit for us. And a lot of other album cuts that Martin's been involved in. He's a great writer and a great person. But Sing, yeah, Sing was another one. That was kind of disappointing, too, that it did fly under the radar. It was a big budget movie and soundtrack. And Dean Pitchford wrote most of the stuff for Footloose. And so they thought it was going to be something along those lines, you know. And I did have a blast recording that song. It's one of my best vocals. Peter Wolf produced it. Like you said, Dean Pitchford, Jonathan Cain, and Martin Page wrote it. Vivian Campbell plays guitar on it.
Really?
Vivian Campbell. Yeah, wow. That's kind of odd.
Wow.
And all that great group of singers, background singers we were talking about, Saida Garrett and Philip Ingram and a bunch of those guys are all singing background.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Any plans? Well, I wanted to ask you this. Where'd you do these Christmas tracks at?
I did those in Nashville. Went down there and we cut them. We cut the two songs in about 4 hours. My manager is really good friends with a guy in Nashville named Danny Frisell, who is a producer and a writer and does a lot of work around Nashville. So Danny put the guys together. He put the players together, got the studio, and you know, we went in and knocked them out, knocked the two songs out in about 4 hours. Tremendous group of
recently.
We did it in September.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
Yeah.
Do you know this producer, Mr. Yeah. Nashville over there?
Yeah, yeah. That's where I'm at. I've lived in Nashville for 28 years.
Yeah, Dan's great, man.
Yeah.
They put together some awesome players for me.
Where? What studio did you use?
I knew you'd ask me that.
Blackbird?
No. Oh, gosh.
It's all right.
I can't remember off the top of my head.
It was a studio.
Yeah. It was a good studio.
Yeah.
Studio A.
Great studio. Yeah.
Studio A. No, B, A. It was A.
Yeah.
So there's two Christmas songs.
Yeah.
Great.
Yes, and they're right here on the screen right now. Yeah. You can go here with your camera, and it'll take you to Spotify. They're there. You're trying it. You're trying to test me, aren't you, Bobby? Yeah.
Really.
And then you can also go here, and this takes you to Mickey Thomas, the Starship Control website, where merchandise is, tour information, pictures. You know, you've had John Roth. I met John Roth after a Bobby Kimball tour. I was doing a project in Memphis, and I can't remember if he played guitar on something, but he had like a double wide at this time, because I don't think he was there that much.
Yeah.
And I remember he opened the door, and there was like no furniture. It was just guitar cords and like contraptions everywhere. Yeah. And guitars. Total man. Unbelievable player.
Great player. You know, he performed, he toured with Winger for a long time before Starship. And he still does some shows with Winger when Starship's not working. And he is a great player. Tremendous. You know, he's irreplaceable for me.
Right. I saw that. Who do you get when John's got to take off and do a Winger? You guys work that thing out.
Yeah, I try not to do any shows if I don't have John, but I have had a couple of shows where we've had a guy named Alistair Green, a sub for John. I don't know if you know Alistair or not, but
no.
He played with
That's a great
name. Elvis Presley. He played with Elvis Presley.
I know, Alan Parsons Project.
Alan Parsons.
Wow. Very cool. Yeah, very cool. So do you guys have more shows this year?
Not this year. I'm done for the rest of this year. My next show is going to be out here, a local show, January 20th at Fantasy Springs. And then, like I said, we're probably going to do about 50 or 60 shows next year.
Great.
They're not all on the books yet, but we're off to a good start.
Howie Simon is who subbed one time. Was there a guitar player named Howie Simon?
Yes, he did. He did one show with us. Howie did a great job. Mm-hmm.
Right. So, Mickey, any plans? Any plans? Or you just don't shut the door on it? Of recording another record, a solo record.
Yeah, I've got lots of plans to record. I don't know about a Starship album. I do want to finish, you know, go in and do enough songs to do a whole Christmas album, hopefully for release next Christmas 2024. And then I'm going to do something I've wanted to do for a long, long time, is an album of R&B covers, soul covers, soul music, you know, the greatest singers that I grew up listening to, like Otis and Percy Sledge. And
I think if you're going to do that, you better go to Muscle Shoals.
I'm either going to go to Nashville or Muscle Shoals, or maybe some Memphis. I might get some Memphis in there too.
Jimmy Jameson's turf,
Yeah, man.
You and Jimmy were dear friends as well, right?
Absolutely. Very close.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Really?
The Rob Levinson, I don't know if he's out there tonight. I'm looking at some of the messages. A lot of messages coming in. He's doing a documentary on Jimmy right now.
Oh, yeah. I'm supposed to talk with him. We're going to try to get together and do an interview with him sometime right after the first of the year for Jimmy's documentary.
Right. Right.
Who are some of your favorite rock singers?
Favorite rock singers?
Yeah.
Seeing that you're an R&B singer.
Yeah.
Joking.
Peter Gabriel. I love Peter Gabriel's voice.
Yeah.
I was a big David Bowie fan. Paul Rogers.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the newer guys I like. I like Tom York.
Mm-hmm.
I like that cat from Muse.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's really good.
Yeah.
John Lennon, of course.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
That's just to name a few.
You know.
All great.
A lot of times we have a lightning round. In the end, we ask stuff like, you know, studio or road, but that's kind of awkward to ask you because you live on the road.
Yeah. For me, it was always up until, you know, 25, 30 years ago, that question was always studio. I always preferred the studio to being on the road. But now, you know, I really enjoy the road more because we don't, obviously we don't do as much in the studio. You know, new albums for an artist of my ilk are not such a big deal. So the road is kind of where it's at. And I kind of enjoy being on stage more now than I ever did at any point in my career because I'm more comfortable with it, more confident with it. I guess I'm also more of the master of my own destiny, so I can kind of call the shots a little more as to, you know, how much time I want to do it, when and where I want. You know, we don't do these grueling 5 or 6 month tours anymore, you know?
Yeah.
I'm more of a road warrior, so I kind of prefer that.
Well, here in Nashville, like the country stuff, they usually leave on Thursday night and get home Sunday night.
Yeah, right.
And you can like actually have a living and go see your kids at school stuff and have a feel like you're married. And it's really a great way to do it.
All of those things.
Yeah.
All of that. And, you know, I love to cook. So I get to get home and get in the kitchen and open some good wine and cook up a good meal. You know, so it's great being able to break it up like that these days.
Yeah.
Does Rachel usually go out with you on the road or? Does she stay back?
She goes about half the time, you know. I enjoy it more when she's with me on the road. It's a lot more fun when she's with me. And but she doesn't, you know, we also have like the house and the dogs and things that need to be taken care of back at home too. So she doesn't go all the time.
Sure.
But probably half and half.
That's cool.
Right. Everybody, one last time I need to explain. This is the real Starship with Mickey right here. This is the real deal. The Starship real deal. Featuring Mickey Thomas. Now, somebody's been posting some Christmas videos on there, but I think they're taking care of that. This is not over here. This is Jefferson Starship with one original member, Peter. What was his name?
David Freiberg.
David Freiberg. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. He's a San Francisco guy.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
A very nice gentleman too, I might add.
Isn't he involved in the new takeover of the plant?
Yeah, he was there for a couple of meetings and a couple of events that they had there. I'm also a little bit involved in that as well. You know, I mean, I've spent so much time recording there, and so much of my music was created at the plant that I'm also involved in trying to preserve it as well.
Oh, great. I didn't even know that was happening. That's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, they were going to just tear it down at one point, I think, but it's, the whole project is coming along now. I mean, it's functioning now. It's a functioning studio where you can go in there and work. And
right.
Does it have the same boards in there? I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I'll forget, you know, that when Arnie had it.
Probably not. Those are probably somewhere in somebody's home studio, somebody that had the money and the knowledge about. I just saw there's a studio out here called the Church, which is a nice, huge studio. It's been open for, I think, about a year. And they have one of the boards, the board from one of the really great recording studios in LA from the 80s. It's a Trident board. And
at the Church in Oklahoma, and
that's a famous one in Tulsa, right?
Yeah, no, Tulsa. I went there.
Yeah, this is a new place out here called the Church. It was actually a church, but now it's a recording studio. So,
wow,
right?
Yeah. So in other words, the record plant boards are probably in some cool studio somewhere around the country.
What happened to Arnie? Is he around anymore?
You know, I don't know. I haven't heard or seen Arnie in probably 25 years, so I'm not sure.
Okay. Well, Mickey, it is. Thank you for today.
You're welcome.
we honored Bobby, and that's what it was meant to do because of your part in the film and where it's going with that. And I know if Bobby could, he would tell you how much he loves you, and he said it before.
Oh, so, he's told me many times. We've told each other many times, and I do love him, and we've had some amazing times together, you know, over the years, singing, being on stage, or just hanging out, you know. Just
PGA events?
Yeah. Just being two crazy Southern boys at times, you know. We've had a lot of fun.
That's great, man.
And we thank you for coming, taking your time out to come on here. I also wanted to, you know, get people directed in the right places.
Yeah, thank you for that.
I get a lot of questions about it, believe it or not. There's a lot of rockers from my hometown of Detroit that are huge fans of yours, and there was some things crossed up there. I mean, some of them didn't believe me, and I was trying to tell them, it's over here. It's not there.
It's not over there, right.
Not over there, there.
Over there. Now, come on over to the real deal.
That one is actually over in the underwear.
Yeah, somewhere over there. Yeah, you know, I try not to, I don't want to be too disparaging, but I'll just say that I think you'll have a much better listening time if you come to our show.
Well, you'll definitely hear some vocals in key.
Yeah.
Yeah, so David, though, you guys are friends, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't see him, you know, I haven't seen him in a long, long time, but we were together in Jefferson Starship back in the early 80s, and yeah, he's, like I said, he's a really, really sweet man, a really, just a good human being.
That's great.
Well, that's good. Well, Mickey,
just stop singing Sarah.
Yeah, on the commercials.
Yeah.
I don't think it's him. It's not a bass player. It's like a chubby guy and an older woman with long hair.
It might be the girl singing that. But she and David, I think, sing Nothing's Gonna Stop Us Together. I think she does sing Sarah. And David sings Jane. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Hey, Mickey, was there a Jane?
No.
Okay.
I just needed a name.
We all got to know.
Yeah.
Just a great word that came with the melody?
Yeah, you know, at the point in time when it came out, a lot of people thought, well, is it Jane Fonda? You know, because she was obviously very popular. Is it Jane Curtin from Saturday Night Live?
Yeah.
Jane Mansfield?
Jane, yeah. So, you know, we just kind of... anytime anybody would surmise who Jane might be, we just kind of go along with it. Say, yeah, it's all of those.
My sister thinks it's
a composite figure, you know. So
my sister Jane thinks it's for her. So I
absolutely. There you go.
It's for every Jane.
Every Jane.
When you're in there doing that record, and you're coming to the last chorus, and you're like on some of the last background vocals, and you hear this song just killing it, and all of your vocals just killing it, are you thinking, I think we got something on this one, guys?
Yeah.
I mean, that has to be a little bit obvious. Yeah. Some of them, you just go, this one's really special.
Well, when I first heard the song, that was the song that kind of was a deciding factor for me joining the Jefferson Starship. When they played Jane for me, and we started jamming on that, I thought, okay, yeah, there's something here. This is
That's
pretty
powerful.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I can't wait for you to hear this double album. You're loaded everywhere in there from the stuff we did before, and it's been built up even more from, I know I sent you some roughs and I probably bothered you. You're like, I've already heard this, but
no, I love it. I love it.
It's been built up. Joel Taylor is chimed in. He says, Joel Taylor, the drummer, says, howdy.
Yeah.
To Mickey.
Hey, Joel.
Actually, Joel toured extensively with Peter Wolf. He did a lot of touring with him. I think it was him and Carp. And this gentleman, I have to read this to you because, Mickey, I fucking love your voice, dude. I've been playing guitar for over 50 years. Used to play We Built This City, Jane Fool Around and Fell in Love, and various cover bands I was in. Thank you for your talent and inspiration. It doesn't get much better than that.
Well, you're very welcome. Yeah, I appreciate
it. Very nice.
Right.
Yeah.
You've inspired so many people, Mickey, and I know when Ken Tamblyn's got to take your voice and analyze it for a video, he's like Sammy Hagar's cousin, the vocal coach guy.
He, yeah.
He, He breaks down your voice and Bobby's voice quite a bit. I've seen him do it a few times, actually. But anyway, we thank you so much for joining us on Between the Speakers. Mm-hmm. And we'll share the link with you later.
Thank you, guys. You're very welcome. I enjoyed talking to you.
Have a great holiday. And thanks for all the music, man, the soundtrack to my life. I really appreciate it, as everyone does.
And Mickey's latest holiday releases one more time. Mickey Thomas, Classic Christmas on Spotify. It's on Apple Music. I don't think really anybody, I don't like people going and grabbing the YouTube because they're just generated. And really the artist, unless they opt for that YouTube part, they don't really make anything from it. And we barely make anything as it is from Spotify and Apple Music. So probably more stream away on there than anywhere. But
yeah, you get a better sound quality.
Yeah, you will. And so there's his latest releases. And of course, we pointed out the website. Thank you, Mickey. Tell Rachel, send her our best.
I will.
And we appreciate you, man.
She's got dinner waiting for me right now.
All right. We will let you go. I'll let you know when your vocals are comped and I'll send you and we can talk it through. Okay, man?
Please do. I can't wait to hear it.
Thank you again for everything, Mickey.
Take care, Mickey.
Thanks, guys.
Okay. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.